morning. Welcome to Struggles of the Spirit. I'm your host, the Reverend Lee Udell. Thank you for tuning in to this program today. We're continuing to look at the year 2000 and thereafter in terms of what we might expect, where we have been, what our dreams and hopes are, and what is reality. And what we're doing today is to talk about education here in Vermont, particularly about education in primary and middle school and possibly some secondary education. And we have a guest who is Dr. Nancy Ellis. She's employed at the University of Vermont, and she has done a lot of work in this area. So she's going to enlighten us about some things and get us thinking about where we would like our education for children to go. And we're delighted to have you, Nancy. Glad that you would come out on this sort of cold, blustery day. Thank you for being here.
Well, thank you, Lee. I appreciate the opportunity to be here.
So I think our viewers will enjoy it, too. So please, people, phone in at 12:15 and until 12:30 and with your questions. So jot things down as we go along if there's some things that really speak to you or raise questions or make you surprised or bring up issues that have been really of important issues for you. Please make a note so that we can really process that material. You can be a third member here in our studio. So you had said, Nancy, you'd like to give us an overview, maybe?
Well, I'll give you an overview from a high altitude.
Fine.
Meaning I won't. I'll try to pick out some themes and perhaps project into the future on the basis of the past. Mm-hmm. I heard a quote last week. It's not original, but I thought it was pretty good. And here it is. It said, planning for the future without knowledge of the past is like trying to plant a cut flower. I thought that was kind of good.
Yes.
So what I'd like to do first is talk a little bit about the past in education, and then especially what's been going on in Vermont in the more recent past, and bring up some issues that I think we're beginning to see emerge right now.
Mm-hmm.
So there are a couple of threads that I see running through the whole public school movement in this country. One is, and the two threads wind around the issue of, do we believe that all children should be educated? Do we think all children can learn? And so the two threads are the business model, the efficiency model. Yes, we think all children can learn, and they should learn in the most efficient way possible. The other thread is, yes, we think all children can learn. All children learn better if they have experience and if they understand, and that takes time and it isn't efficient.
Mm-hmm.
So what happened in the 19th century was, with the beginning of the public school movement, was an effort to stop the crime and corruption in the streets and teach everybody, teach immigrants English, to provide some kind of law and order, and it seemed that education would be the answer for the masses. So public schooling then was the idea of educating everybody in public schools was developed apart from the idea of educating the elite in the classics, either in this country or in what began as Ivy League, the present-day Ivy League colleges and universities.
Am I putting you on the spot? But when in this country, maybe not in Vermont, but when in this country did education for the masses begin?
Well, I think It developed through homeschooling, really, mm-hmm. kind of developed into public schools. Horace Mann was one of the great mm-hmm. founders of the public school movement, and I believe it was around the 1850s where all of that began. It grew into then an efficient model, modeled on the business community, modeled on the emerging factories, where you could, you took in raw materials that had to be molded into a product with some kind of integrity and uniformity of quality,
mm-hmm.
so that the idea was, if we can do this efficiently and well, we'll have young people coming out of our schools who can work to promote the richness and what was then seen as progress of this country, the economic progress. So these people would be able to work in the factories, they would be able to follow orders, they would have a fairly uniform quality of their work, they'd be responsible, they'd get to work on time. So that's what the schools did. They taught them, besides the basics of reading and writing and mathematics, they taught them to be on time, to follow orders, etc. That was the idea, anyway.
When you hear people say, I want to go back to the old basics, reading, writing, and arithmetic,
right?
Are they looking back to that time?
I think so. But not to... children weren't really taught specifically to do critical thinking. Mm. They weren't encouraged to be critical of the system, whatever system they happened to be living in. They certainly weren't critical of a democratic system. They were growing up in the democratic system, but there, I don't believe, was very much done in the schools around political issues. They were taught facts about where the major rivers were in mm-hmm. the world, but not to do some critical thinking about
how we treat them, or how we maintain them, or how industry,
right.
Where it should dump its discharge wastes.
Right, or even political systems.
Mm-hmm.
There were black and white political systems. Communism was bad, democracy was good, but we didn't really try to help students understand how to tell the difference on their own.
Mm-hmm.
Except maybe in the more elite colleges and universities. And there, at least a lot of people think that at the elite colleges and universities, we were training people to become the decision makers and management and to do critical thinking.
Mm-hmm.
So the question is, now, if we think all children should be educated and all children can learn, what do we want them to learn? Do we want everyone to learn to be decision maker?
Mm-hmm.
Do we want everybody to learn to be a critical thinker? Or do we just want some people to be critical thinkers and other people to follow orders?
Hmm.
So let me trace these two strands through a little bit. John Dewey, whom I'm sure you've heard of.
Famous Vermonter, isn't he?
Yes.
He's a graduate of the University of Vermont, I understand.
And he's buried there.
He's buried there.
Right,
yes, right. By the Ira Allen Chapel.
Right. He thought that everyone can learn, and that we learn best through experience,
mm-hmm.
that we need to understand that we aren't well-educated people if we know a lot of facts. We're well-educated if we understand, if we know the process for learning, if we're curious, interested human beings. So his strand of thinking was called progressive education, and there were a lot of misinterpretations of his theory, of course.
Mm.
And a lot of schools got started with that as the background, or with that as the main idea going through the education that they were providing for children. And that was really at odds with the efficiency model schools that were really training the masses to take orders and not to think for themselves. So there were lots of arguments between these people at the different ends of the spectrum up through the first half of the 20th century. Let me jump ahead now to what happened in Vermont. An interesting thing happened. We all have heard about Sputnik and the return to an emphasis on science in education in the 1960s.
I remember when that Sputnik came out, and suddenly there was this sense of horror that we were behind the Russians, and they
right.
were more interested in science and math than we were, and their interest was bearing practical, political results. And
exactly.
we suddenly woke up.
We weren't number one anymore.
No.
Oh,
no,
heavens,
a shock, a real shock, you know.
So I went home and I dug up a copy of the Vermont Design for Education.
Mm-hmm.
I don't even think there are many of these around anymore.
Mm-hmm.
But that came out in 1971 and was an answer in the Deweyan mode for what some people thought we should be doing in education to improve things in Vermont. So I'd just like to read a couple of things here.
Please do.
You get the idea.
Mm-hmm.
It's written in, maybe you can see it, it's cartoon form. So there are only a limited number of points here. It's a tiny little booklet, easy to read, 17 points. That's all there are. And each one has a title and a cartoon and a little paragraph. So I'll just read a couple of the titles. The first one is, the emphasis must be upon learning rather than teaching. The second one is, a student must be accepted as a person. I'll skip ahead a little bit. Education should strive to maintain the individuality and originality of the learner. Well, that isn't the efficiency model, is it?
No way.
We're not turning out
no.
batches if we're maintaining individuality and originality. Emphasis should be on a child's own way of learning through discovery and exploration, through real rather than abstract experiences. There's John Dewey written all over that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Let's see. The teacher's role must be that of a partner and guide in the learning process. An individual must be allowed to work according to his own abilities. Well, that sounds a lot like today's learning style theory, multiple intelligence theory, a lot of the things that people are quite attached to right now.
They aren't so new and unique.
Not really.
Really.
No. So then, in 1992, and we're jumping ahead now, 20 years,
mm-hmm.
We had another document in Vermont, and this was, there's a message from Rick Mills here. So Rick Mills was the commissioner at this time. A Green Mountain Challenge. And this was a document that tried to set some goals for Vermont. After, you remember probably in the 80s, there were a lot of national reports that came out debunking the way education was going at that
mm-hmm.
point, and saying our country isn't competing economically with the other countries. We have to catch up. Really a lot like the Sputnik scare.
Mm-hmm.
So Vermont had its own education goals. And there are four here. Vermonters will see to it that every child becomes a competent, caring, productive, and responsible individual and citizen, committed to learning throughout life.
So those are not just academic goals
at
all.
Not at all.
Some people might say those are parental goals and dreams and hopes.
Right. And some people don't like these attached to public schooling.
Mm-hmm.
The second one is, Vermonters will restructure their schools to support very high performance for all students. The third one is, Vermont will attract, support, and develop the most effective teachers and school leaders in the nation. That's a pretty high goal.
Yeah.
Goal four is, Vermont parents, educators, students, and other citizens will create powerful partnerships to support teaching and learning in every community. So we go from the goals for the student to the schools supporting high performance, and then attracting good teachers and leaders, and finally, partnerships with community. Here again, I think we're still in the pretty much in the Dewey camp. Then there was, in this document, there were the beginnings of the Vermont Common Core. And that's what came next, the development of Vermont Common Core through focus forums in every town in Vermont, supported by the Department of Education. And people attended those in droves, really, and had their goals and their input documented by the Department of Education in Vermont. And then that was all collated and summarized. And that came out as the Vermont's Common Core of Learning. And this was a little newspaper supplement. In what year? I'm not sure what year this came out, but I will tell you in a minute. 1994.
Oh, recent?
Very recent, yeah. Hmm. So the Vermont Common Core of Learning had only four big points. The question was, at all these focus forums, what do we want our children to be learning in schools, in the public schools? What do we want our children to be learning? And the four categories that came out of these public interviews and focus forums were communication. We want our children to communicate well. We want our children to be good problem solvers, and that means critical thinking and all of that. And the third one was, we want our children to have a commitment to lifelong personal development. And the fourth one was, we want our children to be socially responsible. And that was the common core that a large number of Vermonters came up with. Not facts, but these are our goals for education. So then, now finally, out of that then came the Vermont framework. And that was in its published in its final form just a couple of years ago. I guess maybe 3 years ago. Well, no, a little more. 1996.
Mm-hmm.
So the Vermont framework of Vermont's framework of standards and learning opportunities includes the Common Core, communication, problem solving, personal development, and social responsibility, and adds on content. So here we finally come to fields of knowledge. And the fields of knowledge are separated into three, science, math, and technology, history and social sciences, and arts, language, and literature. So they're grouped that way. So if you think of a grid with the vital results going one way and the fields of knowledge going the other way, this is saying, the framework is saying, we want our children to be able to communicate in the areas of arts, language, mm-hmm. literature, mm-hmm. science, math, technology, and so forth. We want them socially responsible in all these content areas, and so forth. So that's where we are right now. The state is now assessing. They have an assessment program. So that they're testing to see if students in the schools are meeting standards that are outlined in the Vermont framework. So there, of course, is a lot of controversy now.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to ask you now, where do you see the controversies here or the problems? This is where we're going. This is where I see, anyway, we are right now. We're dealing with the standards here. We're trying to assess on the basis of the standards. We're trying to figure out, are we doing the job?
What was the first one? Was it math and science?
Science and math and technology grouped together.
Mm-hmm. I think some people are not, in terms of their gifts and interests, are not, don't move in that direction. They're not, so there's a built-in conflict. What do you do with those students?
Well, do you think that people, if they're not gifted in science or mathematics, that they don't need to know anything about science or mathematics?
No, I don't mean that way, but I mean in terms of high performance is what I mean.
Well, what do you mean by high performance?
Well, school systems have standardized tests, and they worry over how well students meet those scores. That's what I'm talking mm-hmm. about. And then they compare them with other states and in Vermont, others, mm-hmm. other towns in Vermont, and they worry over where we are, and then they even worry over other countries where their children are. And my daughter was interested in a lot in literature and some of the arts. She wasn't into science and math.
Well, I think for the level where we want students to be, for example, in science, would be that they could pick up the newspaper and read an article with some data that's coming out of a study, for example, on smoking,
mm-hmm.
and figure out whether it's a reliable study. Should they believe the data from this study, what it seems to be saying?
Critical thinking.
Yeah.
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 Well, that's certainly important.
And so it's basic literacy in these areas. I could, for example, just give you an example of what might be in the science standards.
Mm-hmm.
One of the big areas in the science, math, and technology standards is, if I can find it here, for example, the living world. So, the big standard here is students understand the characteristics of organisms, see patterns of similarity and differences among living organisms, understand the role of evolution, and recognize the interdependence of all systems that support life.
Mm-hmm.
So, in kindergarten to fourth grade, or pre-kindergarten to fourth grade, for example, in this area, children would be identifying the characteristics of organisms, looking at how they adapt to their environments.
Mm-hmm.
In grades 5 through 8, they might be identifying modeling and explaining the structure and function. So they'd be looking at cells. And I just visited a classroom today where they were about to dissect a frog mm-hmm. in seventh grade.
Mm-hmm.
So there's an example. So they look at organs and systems of organisms, and as well as plants and individual entities as components of larger systems. So they understand how an organism is a system, a self-contained system, and how groups of organisms work together as systems too. Then in high school, they'd be looking at the difference or the uniqueness of the cell in different organisms. So like comparing the cells in a plant with the cells in an animal,
mm-hmm.
And the structures and functions of the cell, so chemical reactions of cells and so forth, diffusion of materials, direction of by DNA. So in this culture, I think we expect everybody to have a basic knowledge of these kinds of things. So even a person who isn't really gifted in science, you'd expect that they'd have that kind of knowledge, I think.
But listening to those good examples, I taught school on a primary level. I don't know if you knew that, down in New York City.
No, I didn't know that.
At City and Country School, the Little Red Schoolhouse used to send students over for education to mm-hmm. learn how we taught. And
mm-hmm.
I was teaching eight-year-olds about the universe.
Mm-hmm.
And there was one little boy who talked about the universe and its immensity. And this little boy, he wasn't following those standards. He was way ahead. He was like a postdoctoral student. Mm-hmm. He said, well, everything has a beginning, a middle, and an end in life. The universe has to have a spot where it ends. I mean, it has to be congruent with what we experience and everything else in life.
Mm-hmm.
And then I fortunately shut up and just listened to him. And he was quiet for a moment. And then he said, but if there's an end, it must be like a big stone wall at the end of the universe. And then he thought a little bit more. And then he said, but if there is a big stone wall there, what's on the other side? Now you see, that's why I say he's a postdoctoral
yeah.
a fellow. And I let him do that. And I don't know what's happened to him. But, I think that kind of thinking, if it comes out naturally like that little boy, I mean, I didn't pull it out of him.
Mm-hmm.
He
yeah.
shared it. I think that needs to be encouraged. There's a being a clergyman, mm-hmm. A friend of mine gave me a tape to listen to because of my visual impairment, so I can't read it. And it was about a book called Conversations with God. And God, who speaks in this book, says that what is the primary importance of all education on any level is to learn wisdom, and that our society doesn't value wisdom at all.
Hmm.
And so I was listening to these standards and listening for where wisdom might come in. And they said they our society wants information to be learned, but
interesting,
not wisdom.
Well, if you cross this, you see, remember I said we're not just learning, we're not asking students to learn just those facts about the cell.
Mm-hmm.
We're asking teachers to help them cross-hatch this on the grid with, for example, social responsibility.
Yeah, there's wisdom there.
Yeah, so I think when you start doing that, you get to wisdom applied in the different areas. Oh, I think that's so good. And I think children come, in the early years, they come to their teachers, they come to the schools with this kind of curiosity. My 3-year-old grandson, who isn't three anymore, but when he was three, began to get very upset when it got dark at night.
Mm-hmm.
And he would begin to cry. And he thought the sun might not come up again the next day.
Sure.
It wasn't going to bed that was a problem. It was, is there going to be a tomorrow? Finally, his mother was able to set his mind to rest by taking him up on the hill in Burlington and watching the sun go down and very calmly explaining to him how the earth turns. And it would look like it's going down, but the sun is going to be there in the morning and the earth will have made a turn.
Mm. Yeah, the sun hasn't gone away at all. It's
exactly.
Just that our spinning on the earth has taken away our vision of the sun.
But he was doing some higher level thinking.
Yes.
He was predicting. He was predicting enough so that he was very frightened. He was curious,
mm-hmm.
because he was willing to sit there and watch the sun go mm-hmm. down and let his mother explain.
He was willing to learn.
Yes. But I think often we turn kids off in school.
We do.
By somehow shutting down that curiosity. And you know, there's a movie, sometime I think you'd have fun watching it. It's called A Private Universe, and it was one of a series of short films put out by the Annenberg Foundation. They filmed a graduation at Harvard, and they interviewed students in their caps and gowns as they came out of the parade. And the question was, why do you think it's warmer in the summer and colder in the winter? Now, on the film, not one of them answered it correctly.
Really?
Really. Can you? Do you want to try it?
Why is it warmer in the summer?
It's the and colder in the winter.
The Earth is not spinning on its axis vertically in terms of its relationship with the sun. It's on an angle, and so therefore the axis, that slanted axis in wintertime is situated in such a way as that we're more distant from the direct rays, whereas in the summer we're more directly in line because we're you might say more of the upper part of this hemisphere is exposed to the rays. It's the angle of the axis tilt is what makes summer and winter. If there were no angle, it would always be the same.
That's right, yeah. Partly right.
Well, I used to teach science.
But Lee...
I missed something.
You missed something.
What did I miss?
But what you got was that the angle, it's the angle that's important.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I didn't really fully understand this till I was at the dinner table with somebody, and we were talking about this same problem.
Mm-hmm.
As the light over the table came down onto a trivet that had a grid, you could see that it made a little circle
mm-hmm.
on the trivet.
Mm-hmm.
But if you slanted the trivet that had the grid, you could see that the light was much more diffused over more squares on the trivet.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't the distance, it was the angle.
Right.
We're not any farther away from the sun. We're just...
It's the angle. Yeah.
The angle, and if it's... The greater the angle, the more diffuse the light.
Mm-hmm.
So, but yeah. Anyway, in the film, they all concentrated on the distance from the sun. Because we're farther away from the sun, it's colder in the winter.
Really?
So
all their education, they never understood a basic principle.
They hadn't really understood it, yeah. So here we're expecting that students will understand this. Now, whether they will or not, I don't know, but we're expecting that's pretty basic and that everybody does need to understand something as basic as that.
I would say, and I know, I think you would agree with me, I think the problem in education is that if you try to force feed the child, they'll swallow it because you're force feeding them, but they're not really knowing what they're learning. And they might even be
right.
able to repeat what they have been force fed for a test, but they still are not understanding it.
Right. And you bring up tests. We used to test the right answer. Did the student get the right answer?
Mm-hmm.
And if they got the right answer, then we made the inference that they understood.
Mm.
But now, in Vermont, we're doing performance assessment, and we're demanding portfolios so that kids have to answer, for example, in mathematics, they need to explain in discursive writing, not just by writing formulas or answers, they have to explain how they arrived at a solution.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they get extra credit if they can arrive at their solution in a correct solution a number of different ways.
Mm-hmm.
So we're demanding a lot of students. This is also changing the way Vermont teachers are teaching. And the same thing is happening in the area of writing. We're asking students to write pieces for portfolios that
mm-hmm.
are being graded on the basis of not just grammar and not just organization, but is there significant voice and tone here? If it's intended to be a persuasive piece, does it actually persuade? And so there are rubrics and ways of for scorers to decide whether they're really whether they're really writing quality material. This isn't efficient.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why sometimes Vermont gets nailed on their inefficiency and on the reliability. Is one scorer going to judge the same as another scorer? And we think, yes, we can do that. But again, it isn't efficient. We have to figure out ways of looking at Vermont by taking smaller samples and not testing every single child in order to find out how well we're teaching writing and how well we're teaching mathematics.
There is a theory of learning that I don't fully understand the details of, which I digested it somewhat, but you may know a lot more about it. I remember I was always mystified going through the school system, not just in grammar school, but in college and seminary as well. There were those students who study together for a test, and it seems to help them.
Mm-hmm.
For me, to study with others does not help me at all. I have to have the book or my notes in front of me, and to sort of to somewhat memorize what I have written or what's in the book, and then to see if I can remember it. Then I get a blank sheet of paper and I write down the key points that I can remember. That's how I study. And
mm-hmm.
then I heard something about, there are technical names for this, that people who have to write something is one type of learning.
Mm-hmm.
And then there are others who is an auditory, mm-hmm. and that they learn best hearing. Now, do you know what I mean?
I think you're talking about learning styles.
Yeah. I think our viewers might be fascinated. They might learn something about themselves just briefly mentioning learning styles.
Well, they won't learn very much from me because I don't really know a lot about learning styles. And I guess I haven't, I don't believe that there is very good evidence that people are predominantly one learning style or another. I think that we all have elements of being able to learn in a number of different ways. We also have multiple intelligences,
mm-hmm.
so that some of us are more gifted mathematically, others are more gifted linguistically,
mm-hmm.
but we all have a spectrum of highs and lows within the whole spectrum of all learning ability, multiple learning intelligences. What am I saying? Multiple intelligences that
mm-hmm.
there are.
Mm-hmm.
And Howard Gardner has done probably the most well-known, well-publicized research in this area. He came up with 7 intelligences and has now come up with a couple more that he thinks are significantly important. One of them, I believe, is a spiritual intelligence.
Mm.
And there again, whether we're talking about learning styles or intelligences, we all have a piece of each style or each intelligence. But then you ask, well, what does this mean in schools? What do we do with that? And I think it means that when a teacher is facing a classroom of 25 students, the teacher probably has the pretty nearly the full range of learning styles and intelligences
mm-hmm.
there.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the teacher's job to address as many, as much as possible, as many of the learning styles and intelligences as possible. And the most recent brain research is saying that all children need to have a rich environment.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the message for us educators here is to provide as rich an environment for all of us, all of our students as possible, and to include the different learning styles we think there might be, that we think there are, that we think exist, to address all of them at some time or another.
Time for our viewers to phone in is coming soon. But as we talked on the phone, you told me some fascinating things about how well people learn if they are in a homogeneous group or in a heterogeneous group, if mm-hmm. the people they're with are all very much like them, or if they're different. You want to talk a little bit about that?
Sure. I'm working with some teachers right now to help them deal with heterogeneous groups of students.
Would you tell our viewers what heterogeneous is?
Heterogeneous means that you have students in one group who might be different ages. They certainly have different intelligences, different learning styles. They're not all the same. The same would be if you group them homogeneously and everybody was pretty much the same. So, for example, in my first grade classroom, when I went to first grade millions of years ago, there were three reading groups. There were the robins and the bluebirds and the cardinals or something, and everybody knew that the cardinals were the top. They had the highest reading ability. That was homogeneous grouping.
Mm-hmm.
And the turkeys were
the slowest.
The lowest, right. Didn't even mention those. So we're saying that children learn best if the bluebirds and the robins and the cardinals and the turkeys are all together in a group. And if the teacher then can be alert enough to figure out that everybody has something that they can contribute here, that everybody has a valuable ability or a set of valuable abilities.
Can you explain how that's possible? I guess you told me there have been studies that have shown this as a fact.
Well, not everybody has the same high ability. So for example, in a reading group, if you just have the kids reading, there might be somebody who is the best reader, definitely. But it would be the teacher's job to figure out a task for that group to do that included reading, but also included some other possibilities for the child who perhaps can't read at all, but is a good problem solver.
Mm-hmm.
There might be something that would have to be some problem that would have to be solved. Perhaps the good reader would read the problem and maybe even teach some of the group some words in that reading that the rest of the group didn't know how to read. And then the problem solver might be able to think of a strategy for solving the problem. The one who's good in mathematics who's really good in mathematics, might be able to set it up as a mathematical formula,
mm-hmm.
and so forth. But the teacher would need to set up the task so that there are a number of different possibilities, a number of different avenues of entree into this problem. So, what we're helping teachers do is to understand that process and to capitalize on the children who are doing something well, to make public what they do well, and make it believable to the rest of the group that the person that maybe is the poor reader or non-reader is actually a very smart person.
Mm-hmm. So they don't feel they're a ninny.
Right, right.
A dunce.
Exactly. And then, you know, when you're participating, you learn more.
Sure.
So the one who can do the problem solving but maybe can't read the problem begins to participate, and by doing that, enters the conversation and does some learning. And our studies have found that the more they participate, the more they learn, especially if they were low to begin with, if their achievement level has been pretty low to start with. And I think that's because they had such a long way to go.
Mm-hmm.
The students who are already high achievers achieve better than if they hadn't been in the group, but maybe the learning gain isn't as huge because they were already near their ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we're not sure why that's happening, but that's what the data is showing anyway.
Let me interrupt for a moment. It's time for our viewers, for you to phone in and to tell us your response to what you're hearing, your questions, your thoughts, your ideas.
Challenges.
Yes, yes. We are disappointed if you don't phone in. We really like to hear from you to know how well we're doing and whether what we are talking about is of interest to you. This is Struggles of the Spirit, the program that is on every week, and learning how to become an adult and it is a struggle of the spirit, no question about it. I think, as I look back, I think my formative years before I was an adult were probably the hardest years of my life. So I think most people would agree. So give us a call, please. We'll continue to talk. And as soon as we hear you're on the line, we will stop. And we have about 14 minutes for your feedback. So please give us a ring. We've been talking with Dr. Nancy Ellis on this whole subject of education.
Well, I have a couple of props here while we're waiting for a phone call.
Okay.
I have a book here that...
excuse me, there is a problem if we can't have our technician come in at that point.
I'll just hold it up here and I'll read the title.
She's manning the phone.
So the audience can see that it's...
We have a call.
Oh.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you, Karen. Please welcome our caller.
Hello.
Hello.
My name is Russell.
Karen, could you turn up the volume
well.
A little?
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah, somehow it's very dim, but you'll come across.
Okay. Do you have any way of suggesting how your ideas in education would apply to religious education, to the kind of things that are happening in Sunday schools, for instance?
I think we should repeat the question for our viewers who may not be able to have heard what was said. The question was, do you have any ideas how this education you're talking about might be dealt with in a religious education? Is that correct, sir?
That's correct, yes.
Ah, okay, now we hear you. Fine. Good.
Well, I think I should hand the podium over to you, Lee. You're the religious education specialist. Would you give it a try?
I'll try, but you're the educational pro here. I feel very strongly that religious education, generally, the way it's done in many churches and synagogues and mosques is is force feeding children with data and information, and is not really helping the child to interpret and understand their own experience, their own religious experience, their own human experience, and that somehow the religious organizations and somehow the religious organizations get fixated on trying to force feed children. I have worked with a lot of dying children in the hospital, having been a hospital chaplain for all about 30 years of my life, and young children are quite profound and have very weighty experiences of God, and most of the time they're not asked about their experiences. They're not asked to talk about how they know God. We instead want to get them to know what the Anglican Communion is, how it's different than the Roman Catholic Communion, or how many colors there are in the church year. That's what we want them to do. That's not where the child is.
That's right, and I think that's exactly what I'm trying to help teachers do, is listen to their students. Mm-hmm. By listening to what their competencies are and to build on those. I have a student in one of my classes at the University of Vermont the other day who said he's in an education class that he takes with me. He's also learning to be a ski instructor. And he said his coach, or rather the person who is coaching him to be a ski instructor, so his professor on the slopes told him that he would do best if he capitalizes on whatever his skiing pupils are doing that's right. To not tell them what they're doing wrong, but to look at what they're doing right and to tell them what that is. So he's learning on the slopes from his ski professor exactly what I'm trying to teach him in the class. To capitalize on and to listen and to watch for what our students are doing well and build their confidence in their ability then to step out and do maybe something else well until they're doing the whole thing well, till they're skiing down the slopes or till they're reading the whole book.
That's neat.
Isn't that neat?
That's neat. You know,
and I think that when the little book that I was holding up here is called Working for Equity in Heterogeneous Classrooms. All our classrooms are heterogeneous. We fool ourselves into thinking we've ability grouped, I think, and we try. But even so, we're always going to have heterogeneous classrooms, and especially in this culture right now, in this community. We have such wide diversity of socioeconomic classes, family income, race, ethnic origin, gender orientation. Mm-hmm. You think of all of the different kinds of heterogeneity that we have, and it's enormous. So we need to work for equity, and I think we need to believe that everyone can understand and learn in the Deweyan kind of way, and be critical thinkers. We don't have to subject some of our society to learning by memorizing or learning to follow orders. I think we can provide an education that respects the humanity of everybody.
I like very much what you say, because I have sometimes run across teachers who would be frustrated by all these differences between one child and another, and because they want to get the children to learn the material that they're supposed to memorize and know, and all of this personal stuff is in the way.
Exactly. That's exactly the problem. And that's what most teachers feel.
But it's not in the way.
It's not really in the way, but most teachers feel that it's in the way.
Yeah.
Before we sign off here, I just want to mention another study, an even more recent study in Vermont, a report really, that came out last year that I think makes the point about heterogeneity in Vermont. And so we have this report on racial harassment in Vermont public schools, it's called. And this has been sort of swept under the rug, but it came out in February 1999. And this week, in fact, in the Times, the local, the Vermont Times, the weekly free newspaper you can pick up at your grocery store.
Yes.
It was February 2nd, so it's probably last week's issue already. Is a big headline called "Rooting Out Racism." So we still have that with us, and the point here is that the racial harassment report has begun to disappear already, that the issues that are before the legislature for more spending to address this issue are sort of falling onto the back burner. I think we need to keep that in front of us if we're still going to work for equity, for heterogeneous classrooms that respect the right of all children to learn.
I've known a number of Native American Abnakis, particularly in Vermont, and they have told me how they have been harassed, and and most of them hide. They don't they don't let people know they're Native American because it gets them into difficulty.
Exactly, it's more common in Vermont than we will acknowledge.
Oh, definitely, definitely.
And I think that it's not just racial. This report is about racial harassment, but the same kind of harassment takes place for students who are not from wealthy families, and for all kinds of differences.
Sure. Yeah, I'm going to the British West Indies for my Christmas vacation. Where are you going?
I'm going back to my trailer park.
That's right. People come from different spaces.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
I don't know if we have any more callers. We're just about out of time. If there is one more call, please call quickly. We're talking about Vermont education. Here with Dr. Nancy Ellis. The phone number is on your screen.
Well, this has been very nice of you to put up with me for an hour.
Well, what do you mean, put up with you? I think you have a lot to offer. You're not a professor for nothing.
Well, I enjoy this. I enjoyed talking with you.
Well, thank you, Nancy. I've never had much occasion to talk at length with you, and this has been a special time.
Good, good.
We've known each other, speaking to the viewers, known each other, well, since...
Many years.
Since I won my first... year or second year I came here, 1971 or 72.
That's right.
So thank you for being here. Our time is
up.
I hear the music coming. So I appreciate your finding a space in your schedule for us. We've been listening here to the words of Dr. Nancy Ellis, UVM professor and expert in education.